morning, fellow citizens. I'd like to welcome all of you to this brief informational session on why you don't matter. Now, I know many of you have chronic conditions, mental or physical, while others have been denied health insurance for other reasons. However, I want to assure you that you are all viewed as equally economically worthless by health insurance companies. And here's why. Take car insurance. When deciding where to offer insurance to a client and at what rate, the car insurance company compares the risk of the client to the money the client will provide. A teenager who crashes his car because he was texting drunk and banging his head to Metallica will find it difficult to get car insurance. Of course, unlike people's health, all cars are required by law to have insurance because cars are important. So think of it this way. A farmer will keep a healthy cow alive because once that cow has been fed and fattened up on corn and small pieces of other cows, slaughtered and gutted, the cow will yield the farmer a net profit. A cow with autism, diabetes, sclerosis, or depression, however, might not survive long enough to become massively obese and butchered. Even if it did, the farm might get shut down if the FDA heard about it. So, chronically ill people and those who otherwise can't get insurance of a certain basic quality, think of yourselves as useless cows. I hope that puts things in perspective. Now, there's been much talk about the so-called public option of government-run healthcare choice, and there's a rumor going around it has popular support. That's a complete lie. Only 72% of Americans approve it. I realize, though, that some members of the audience might belong to this radical fringe majority, so allow me to tell you why your beliefs hold as little merit as a theory of evolution. As you've heard from a variety of self-proclaimed experts, government competition in the health insurance field will inevitably choke out private businesses, like what the U.S. Postal Service did to DHL, and UPS, and FedEx. One needs only to look at Congress for more verification. How on earth can private enterprise compete with such a flawless, seamlessly orchestrated machine, the paragon of efficiency that is the U.S. government? Of course, once Congress does assume complete control of our nation's health, it's only a matter of time before the land of the free spirals into a socialism-y, fascist-y, communism-y, totalitarian state, evidenced by nations that already have government-run healthcare, globally notorious cesspools like Canada, France, and Sweden. Another clear problem is affordability. Now, some might say the United States already spends 200% more per capita than other nations on healthcare. That's ridiculous. We only spend 136% more per capita than Switzerland, which has the second most expensive healthcare program per person. Now, we spend about 2,500% more than Cuba on healthcare per person, which is the key to giving Americans a life expectancy of a full 6 months longer than our neighbors in Havana, and cementing citizens of the United States in the prestigious position of being the 27th longest living population. And yes, the government may have spent over $700 billion to bail out banks, but that helped money. And some of that was my money. Now, I'm not going to say that the number of zeros on my salary and investments is more important than an individual's livelihood. I'm going to leave it to you to make that intuitive leap. So I pose a question asked by legendary moral authority Glenn Beck on his website. If the public option health plan is so good, why won't politicians agree to have that as their plan? Bingo, Glenster. Politicians' reluctance for a government healthcare option can't just be because the healthcare lobby spent more than $1.4 million a day in 2009 to educate members of Congress on boycotting the public option. The real reason is, every member of Congress has a government-run healthcare plan with no coverage limit, no limitations on pre-existing conditions, 24-hour access to healthcare, and free outpatient care, all financed by millions of taxpayer dollars. You can only assume that their quality of care is so absolutely insufferable that their consciences cannot allow such an abysmal system to prey on their naive constituents. I say we trust them on this one. Recently, a health bill that would expand coverage to millions of these high-risk cows passed in the House of Representatives by the slimmest of margins, and now it's in the Senate. Senator Lindsey Graham has dismissed the bill as dead on arrival, and I only pray that he is right. Why should you care? Don't worry about my paycheck. Worry about your freedom. The House's bill requires every American to have some sort of health insurance for them and their children, bought or received in a federally regulated marketplace. Don't want health insurance? Too bad! The government says you need it. Who are they to tell you that you can't just risk your livelihood and then if you or your kid actually get sick and you can't afford to pay for medical expenditures or go bankrupt in the process, you can't just put the bill in the hospital, which, in order to remain solvent, needs to get the money for your treatment somehow until they increase co-pays and procedure costs for people who have insurance, which needs to be paid by the insurance companies. In order for them to remain solvent, they need to raise insurance premiums so that everybody else is paying more and you're hopelessly broke, huh? Who is the government to say that? That anything else be universal? When has the government told us what we can and cannot do? Generally, this happens every time Congress passes what's called a law. But I, for one, cannot remember a time when Big Gov had the nerve to force a meaningful one onto its own people. Fine, fine. I know some people right now are saying primary education. But the difference between enforcing universal education and forcing universal health insurance is that many first and second graders don't want to go to school simply because they're short-sighted, immature, insufferably self-righteous, and unable to make important life decisions. Adults, in contrast, can generally make wise decisions about which deep-fried candy bar they want gumming up their mouths and arteries. Lastly, there are some real pieces of scum in America. They're the kind that mooches off society, the kind that will inevitably manipulate mandatory healthcare to siphon off taxpayer money by purposefully destroying their own bodies. Are we going to give millions of our country men, women, and children peace of mind just to cater to the needs of this small number of social parasites? Well, would you save a family in a burning house if one of the kids was a little jerk? Of course not. So fellow healthy Americans, stand strong. Stand with your back straight ever since that surgery, and from deep within that chest of yours that feels fine now that you've had a coronary bypass, find the strength to resist this oppression. With your mind sharp and clear from your cocktail of prescription ADD meds, make your voice heard with that wisdom tooth-free mouth of yours, and chant your support for that timeless creed that defines America. For every American, let there be life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, unless I have to pay for it.